I am the Whistler, and I know many things, for I walk by night. I know many strange tales hidden in the hearts of men and women who have stepped into the shadows. Yes, I know the nameless terrors of which they dare not speak. Charles Belden, respectable married man and competent manager of his wife's properties, could not explain the circumstances which had placed him in the living room of his home at a time when he should have been in his office. He had not spent a great deal of time in this room, and certainly not alone. And even now, in a sense, your wife Harriet is here with you, isn't she, Charles? Certainly her presence is felt. And 9 years of being married to Harriet has brought about a certain constancy. Harriet is so very predictable. And the routine of the future seems so very predictable, too. So little chance of change. It seems terribly remote that anything that might make a change will come knocking upon the door of your life.
To trouble you, but it seems I've been walking forever. I've been trying to locate the Belden residence.
Really? I'm Charles Belden.
Oh, Mr. Belden. Of course, you don't know me, but I've come in response to your ad in the Courier. Perhaps Mrs. Belden placed it. Regarding a housekeeper?
Yes. You didn't write Mrs. Belden? Talk to her on the telephone?
No. No, I thought it best to meet her, talk to her in person. You have a problem, I understand, because of the distance.
We haven't been able to persuade anyone to stay very long.
You prefer that I talk to Mrs. Belden?
Oh, yes. It's more in her province, you know. Would you care to wait inside? She'll be back from a morning stroll soon. It's a daily ritual with her.
Do you think it will be all right?
Yes. Do come in. Room's in there. Won't you sit down? Would you care for some tea?
Oh, that really wouldn't be necessary.
Oh, do have some. I'll get it. I'll have some myself. Do stay right there.
It's strange, isn't it, Charles? The effect of that brief moment when you first caught sight of her. There was a vague awakening, a stirring of something inside of you that suggests a beginning and the end of monotony. What was her name? You suddenly realize that you even forgot to ask.
Laurie Edgley. I read of your need in the Courier.
Oh, yes, of course.
Hello, Harriet. I asked the young lady again and thought she should wait.
I'm surprised you're not at work.
Hmm.
No, thank you.
The young lady, I thought...
Laurie.
Laurie, yes. She had traveled a good distance and...
Please,
since we
Charles,
do need her...
You understand, I'm sure. I would have preferred that you'd written us or telephoned.
I understand, ma'am. It was thoughtless of me. I should have thought of references. However, if you just grant me an interview, unless you have someone else in mind.
We haven't, have we, Harriet?
No. However...
I'd appreciate so much if you'd give me a trial. Then, if I didn't prove efficient...
What do you say, Harriet? Laurie is certainly trying to be fair. course, it's up to you.
Yes, it is.
Well, Mr. Belden seems to have accepted you at face value.
Harriet, I fully intended to have her...
Never mind, Charles. You ran out of work to do in the office?
Well, I didn't feel too well. Somehow, I...
Mm. Well, perhaps the tea will help.
Yes.
Since you're here already, Laurie, I suppose we could try it for a week.
Oh, thank you very much, ma'am. And thank you, Mr. Belden.
Not at all. We've waited some time now. A week can't make much difference. Except you might not like us.
Oh, I don't think that, sir.
We'll discuss it later, Laurie. When you've finished your tea, I'll show you where you'll stay.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
When you've time, Charles, there are a few things I'd like to speak to you about. Charles.
Yes. Excuse us, Laurie.
Certainly, sir.
It's the way she looks at you, isn't it, Charlie? Laurie's gentle, lovely look. It stayed in your mind all day, fading in and out of focus as you think about it. Consider its meaning. And somehow you're certain that it's more than a grateful glance, aren't you, Charles? So certain that you haven't even felt the need of sleep. All you can think of is Laurie. Lovely Laurie.
Always include some fruit in Mr. Belden's lunch, Laurie. An apple or a pear.
Yes,
and that cheese is very high in protein value, you know. Mr. Belden works over a desk all day, but I suppose it does consume some energy.
I'm sure it does.
Good morning, Harriet.
Good morning. Here's your lunch.
Thanks.
I hope it will be to your liking, Mr. Belden.
I'm sure it will be, Laurie.
Yes. Well, dinner will be at 7, Laurie. It's my club day. I'll walk with you to the door, Charles.
All right. Goodbye, Laurie. See you this evening.
Don't forget to fix the potatoes the way I told you, Laurie. Not too well done.
Yes, ma'am.
And don't even try the cream sauce until I show you.
No, ma'am.
Do you think you could manage everything?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
No questions?
None, ma'am.
Coming, Charles? Don't forget to get those letters out today, Charles, to the tenants of the Arlington property.
Yes, Harriet, I'll remember.
I'll see you at dinner then.
Yes.
Another working day, isn't it, Charles, in your strange little office downstairs? Only the years have made it unstrange to you, haven't they? Commonplace. With every move part of a routine. There are the letters to write and mail, the balance sheets to total. But there's something else, isn't there? Something that makes this day completely new, different. Yes, Charles, there's Laurie now. This girl who looks at you in a way no one else has in years. Only there's something different now. Yes, oddly different. A vague stirring inside that seems to change even the appearance of the room. Your attitude towards your work, the work of managing Harriet's property.
Charles, in here.
What is it, Harriet?
That young woman, Laura. We've got to get rid of her.
Why, isn't she satisfactory?
Well, as a housekeeper, she seems fine. Excellent.
Then I don't understand.
Well, it happened late this afternoon. Oh, Charles, it upset me so. Mrs. Wilton drove up from the village.
That busybody.
Well, she came here to discuss the situation we had at the club today. She wanted to talk to me privately. Well, you know elections are coming up soon. I'm running for the presidency, and I'm counting on Mrs. Wilton for...
All right, Harriet. What happened?
Well, Laura simply wouldn't answer the door. I finally had to go myself.
Is that all? Harriet, the girl simply hasn't caught on to the routine of things. After all, one day...
It isn't that. I'm trying to tell you. I spoke to her after Mrs. Wilton had gone. Charles... She asked me if she did everything else to our satisfaction, Would we mind if she didn't answer the door or take telephone calls? Well, you see, you're wondering about it, too. Naturally, I demanded an explanation.
Did she give you one?
Well, it isn't satisfactory. Not to me, it isn't.
What did she tell you?
Oh, some weird tale. Ridiculous, if you ask me. Something about coming out here to get away from someone.
Oh?
A man. He's in love with her. She professes to be terrified of him. Says he's threatened to kill her.
And you don't believe her?
Believe her? There's more to it than that, Charles. That girl's a fugitive or something like that.
I wonder.
Wonder?
Yes. Well, she seems so gentle, Harriet. So harmless and gentle. And we've had so much trouble getting anyone to stay.
You mean you don't want us to do anything about it?
If you insist, I'll talk to her. However,
you mean to say that you are not at all alarmed about having that girl in this house while we're asleep? Oh, Charles, I just don't understand you. You're thoughtless, disinterested in everything, even in caring for the money Father left me.
Harriet, please.
No. You're going to talk to that girl, Charles. You're going to talk to her tonight. Dismiss her. She's...
Oh, I'm sorry, sir.
It's all right, Laurie.
I'm going to bed, Charles.
Good night, Mrs. Belden.
Good night.
Laurie, we've just been talking and...
Yes?
Never mind, Laurie. I just want to tell you that you don't have to be frightened. You don't have to answer the door or the phones ever.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Belden. You're so kind to me. Thank you very much.
Really, Charles, I can't borrow someone else's troubles. I have enough of my own. You know I'm due at the club again today. Election day is rushing up on us, and we simply don't know what we're doing.
Harriet, will you listen to me?
My mind's made up. Laurie stays the week, and that's all.
All right, Harriet. I'll take your tray.
Well, I don't see why you put yourself out. You're a busy man. You've always said it. Your work. Laurie's paid to carry trays.
Oh, I don't mind. Besides, it'll give me an excuse. I should tell her.
You should have told her last night, as I asked.
Oh, I just couldn't.
Well, take the tray, then. And if you're not able to tell her, I'll take care of it myself.
Yes, Harry.
Somehow, some way, you must prevent Harriet from carrying out her stern wishes. And as you try to analyze your feelings, you know now, you have known, from the beginning, that Laurie is far more than an attractive servant girl. She's everything to you, isn't she, Charles? And just as she has tried to tell you with every action, every look, you suddenly feel the urge to tell her how you feel.
Laurie? Oh, I'm sorry, Laurie. I didn't mean to startle you.
Mr. Belden, it's quite all right. I suppose I shouldn't have... Well, I guess I was just thinking of him.
I know. Today, it's your afternoon off, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Don't go, Laurie. I mean, the village road, it's terribly slippery in the rain. Why, only last week a car skidded and went off the cliffs. I wouldn't want anything to happen to you, Laurie.
I don't understand.
I know I'm handling this rather badly. I don't know quite how to say it. You see, I've never really been in love before. Don't you understand, Laurie? Don't you understand what I'm trying to say? I love you, Laurie. I've loved you since the first day you came here.
Please, Mr. Belden.
I want to marry you, Laurie.
But you're already married.
I'll find a way to change it all, I promise. And then when I'm free...
I have to be going now, Mr. Belden.
All right, Laurie. But you will think it over, won't you?
You're confident, aren't you, Charles, that once you're free, Laurie will accept your love? Your feeling for her is overwhelming, isn't it? For this girl who so recently walked into your life, looks at you so tenderly, longingly, she must be yours. And later in your office, you realize that it isn't an office at all. It's a prison cell. A prison cell of your own making. The price you've paid through the years for the security Harriet's money provides. Now more than ever, your mind gropes for a final answer.
Charles, Charles, will you come up here, please? I want to talk to you.
Yes, Harriet?
Oh, Charles, I've just been through the most mortifying experience in my life. After all I've done for that ignorant lot of women, electing a silly, illiterate creature like Mrs. Meglin to the presidency.
Oh, yes, the election. You didn't...
No, I didn't. And I'd rather not talk about it anymore. Charles, where's Laurie?
She went out. It's her afternoon off.
Oh, yes, of course. Disappointed?
I don't understand.
Oh, really? Please, Charles, don't you think I've noticed how much you enjoy having that girl in this house? Don't you think I've watched the way you look at her with that sick, stupid look on your face? The way you moon about like a schoolboy? Oh, really, Charles?
Harriet, you're imagining things.
Indeed.
I tell you, it's just that I...
Oh, Charles, you're so amusing. Do you think for one minute that girl is really interested in you?
Oh. Harriet, that's enough.
Oh, you're so terribly dull, darling. So unromantic. I really feel sorry for you. However, you'll get over it. Laurie will be gone in a few days, and then you'll forget all about her. Then you can get your mind back on your work and my money. After all, you'll still have that to think about, won't you? And you'll still have me. Where are you going?
I don't know.
I do. You're going downtown to look for her.
Please, Harriet.
All right, go ahead. You'll be back.
Harriet's attitude is infuriating, isn't it, Charles? And the terrible part of it is that she's so very right. But you don't go after Laurie, do you, Charles? Back in your office, in an item in the weekly paper, you find the answer to all your questions. The story of a fatal accident on the cliffs near your house. Everyone knows of Harriet's daily morning walks along the cliff. A ritual. And everyone knows now how dangerous the cliffs can be during this particular season. It's perfect, isn't it? You have the rest of the day to think it over and make your plans. And with the day behind you, you know exactly what lies ahead, what you must do. Your actions now will provide a total answer, won't they, Charles? Giving you everything. You know that Harriet has already retired with a sick headache, and you must find Laurie. You must know what her answer is before you make your next move.
Say a thing. Just listen to me for a moment. Laurie, I found a way to be free from Harriet. First, I must know how you feel. I've got to know if you want me to go ahead with it. Now listen to me, Laurie, and this is important. You'll not be involved. You don't have to answer, you don't have to say a thing, unless you want to stop me. Shall I go ahead with it, Laurie? I'll do it, darling. And don't be afraid. I'll take care of everything.
Oh, good morning, Charles.
Good morning. Good morning.
Two servings?
Yes. It's been some time since we've had breakfast together.
What?
Really, I wanted to have breakfast so we could talk.
Talk?
Yes. We so seldom get to discuss things. I go to work and you go for your morning stroll, and then, well, club.
I didn't think it mattered.
It does, Harriet. Are you going for your walk this morning?
Well, I thought I would. The rain has stopped. Would you rather I didn't?
Oh, no, no. That isn't it, Harriet. Harriet, it might sound odd to you, but I've been thinking about the two of us, I mean. It disturbs me that we've been having words.
Oh?
Harriet, early in our marriage, we used to take walks together, and it seemed we were able to talk out so many things.
Well, that's true, Charles, but...
I was wondering, could I walk along with you today, this morning?
Well, yes. Yes, of course. But what about the office? Don't you have to...
The office can wait. You know that, Harriet. We're more important.
Yes. Yes, we are. I'd very much enjoy having you go with me, Charles.
We'll walk along the cliffs and...
Yes, yes, I'd like that. Breakfast together and then a walk. Does sound nice, Charles. You know?
Yes.
I'm really glad you thought of this.
Good. I think this will settle a lot of things, Harriet. For the both of us. Now, let's have breakfast together, dear.
It's all over, isn't it, Charlie? The walk along the cliff with Harry. It's the last one you'll ever have to take with her. And now you're anxious to see Laurie again. Talk to her. Gain the reassurance that sweeps over you every time she looks at you. Yes, there's magic in those moments, isn't there, Charles? And an enchantment of beauty that cannot be denied. And after all the waiting, you've settled it finally.
Mr. Belden?
Laurie!
I was just fixing the rooms upstairs.
I know. Never mind that. Listen to me, dear. It's over. Exactly as I said.
Over?
It'll seem like an accident. I'm sure of it, Laurie. It's happened to others. They'll think it was the same with Harriet.
Your wife?
Don't you understand, Laurie? She's dead. Harriet's dead.
You killed her?
Laurie.
No. No, don't touch me. Don't touch me. Keep away from me.
Laurie!
You're nervous waiting, aren't you, Charles? But you're certain that once Laurie has had time to think of what your future together holds for her, she will be back. Walk through that front door just as she did when she first came into your life. Yes, Charles, she has come back, hasn't she? Just as you knew she would.
Laurie. Laurie, the sheriff. What is it? What have you done?
She just told me what you did, Belden. That you killed your wife.
She told you what? It's all right. I want to know. Understand. Laurie, you were in on it yourself. You knew I was going to do it. I told you and you didn't stop me.
That isn't true.
Laurie, last night when you were sitting by the fire...
Last night? But, Mr. Belden, I didn't see you last night.
Laurie, What are you talking about? What are you trying to tell me?
Belden, haven't you ever noticed the way she looked at you? She had very good reason to look at you that way. When she looked at you that way, it was because she had to read your lips. You see, she's deaf.